Hot cars parked on the right spot. Bad man slick and you know. Bad man looking good in the air. Bad man drip to the car. Spot cars parked on the right spot. Bad man slick and you me got a girl on me bed right now. She says she know I leave. She tell me Ruga, me I want to spend the rest of me life with you. Me say no shit. Oh Lord, fly you to Maldives for a day.
Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. It's your boy Victor and I'm really excited to be back. I apologize for going for such a long time. I had some things I had to do, but that's talk for another day. Well, good news for you, I'm back and I'm better, I am happier, and I have better content for you out there, so keep watching. Anyways, for today I'm here with someone that has been very dear to me. She's been like a role model to me. She's been in the entertainment industry for quite a long time now. She's been there for decades, right? And she's someone I really look up to. We all know her, we all love her. She's no one else but Kehinde Bankole.
How do you guys doing?
So Auntie Ken, it's been like a very long time. It's been a while. So how have you been?
The plan is first to embarrass him on his show today. Like to tell you guys how Victor used to be little when I saw him. He used to be like this little kid with ambition, with like big dreams, you know, soft spoken, but like he knew what he wanted. So now, you're not a big boy.
I've become a man now. I've become a man.
I've been good.
So how's work been? What you working on right now?
Oh yeah, great. So you be the first I'll tell, and that's because it's you. You're special. I've said it before. I mean, like I've hinted about this online twice, I think. So officially now, I'm quite putting out there. I'm filming my first project, my very first. We've been up and on. Oh, like we want to do this. We'll announce that we'll be filming in a short while, and then we'll change the story, we'll change the plan. But this time around, we are actually filming by the new year, actually. So my first major project.
I hope you guys heard that. That means something big is hitting your screen. And I advise that all of you get your phones ready, get your laptops ready, get your money ready to go to the cinemas and watch my dear auntie, Auntie Kehinde Bankole. So you heard it from her, not me. Anyways, our first question for you today is like, I would like to know about Kehinde Bankole, your childhood, how it was growing up in the whole African Nigerian way, if you know what I mean.
How my growing up was. Growing up in Nigeria, beautiful, I must say. I mean, things have changed. Those days, your neighbor will raise your child for you. You can, like, I remember that my parents would go to work, and then if you do something naughty, no, you don't have to wait for your parents to get back to get smacked.
So your
neighbor will come and say, what did you just do? Do you think your dad or your mom will be happy about that or whatever not? And then they give you the smacking in advance on behalf of mom and dad, kind of thing. So growing up was like that. But I mean, it puts some kind of fear in kids, a healthy one, because it will keep you disciplined. And my parents were quite disciplined. My mom, a little more religious than my dad. So combination of religious and disciplined equals what you're looking at now. Mm. It was a beautiful time. They were very supportive. God rest their souls now. Both of them are late. My mom would encourage us to do drama trainings, choir rehearsals. Wow. You know, we used to like be in church all those days. Then we were like, maybe just twice a week. But that twice a week seemed like, you know, as a young person, you want to just be playing games all the time, having fun. But today, I'm actually benefiting from those church rehearsals in the Redeemed Church back then, Victory Center, I remember. And what else? It was fun, all fun and games, but they would make sure that all the right things were put in place, all the right things, like, you know, just discipline, love. My parents are very loving, like. Yeah, my dad may not be the hugger, the one that will keep hugging you and saying, I love you, you know, but you could tell he would do anything for his children. He would sacrifice anything for his kids. My mom too was also like that. Like, my mom was extremely protective of her children. it was amazing.
Wow. So what I'm hearing is that we owe your parents a huge thank you to what you become today. So may the Lord rest their souls, and Amen. Wherever they are in heaven, smiling down at you right now, we want to say a very big thank you for our wonderful auntie right here. So my next question to you is, what made you interested in acting, and how did you know that acting was it for you?
Okay, what made me interested in acting? I loved Tyra Banks. I loved Halle Berry. So those two, when I was growing up, I would always like look at their modeling photos. Halle was the actress even as a back then, while Tyra was just modeling back then. Tyra Banks is now doing a lot more than just modeling, but as a then she was just modeling. I would cut their posters and paste them in my room.
Wow.
So obviously you pick interests in someone as like that mentor, far away mentor that doesn't know you, you don't know the person, but you begin to watch the person, like, oh, news about them, what are they doing, what are they looking in like now, what are they interested in, and before you know it, you begin to find out what they're doing. Oh, she's a model. Oh, I feel tall, I feel like I look like her, you know. In your dreams you'd be like, oh, I'm like a Tyra, you know, I'm like a Harley, all these things you joke about, they sometimes inspire you to want to be curious about what those people do. When you look at what they do, if it's something you like and you feel like you guys have like a common interest in that thing, you pick the interests more and then you pursue it. So I pursued modeling first, you know. Then I started modeling and I was like, excuse me, sir, I want more money. Because modeling in Nigeria was slow, I don't know about now, was slow. Then maybe a couple of billboards, even the billboards, you have to be like a very, very, I don't know, a top model to land a billboard project or something. So it used to be like little calendars. I'll be on calendars, I'll be on tabletop. You know, these things, this, I don't know what they call them. Maybe a directory, okay. You know, something small here and there. And then the runway. Tyra Banks made me really love fashion shows, runways, and I would model for Mon Ami. I did a little for Tiffany Amber, I did a little for Adebayo Jones. And then I was like, excuse me, sir, there's no money here. I want more. So I started looking at more. I did beauty pageantry, you know, because the aim was, oh, if I win, I'm going to get a lot of money. And then, oh, I'm going to get a lot of exposure. And then, so I started that. And then from there, I just knew that, look, more means hosting TV shows, more means acting. So essentially, what made me decide to go into acting was M-O-E-R, more. I just wanted more.
Okay, that's a wonderful answer. And knowing the fact that you already made some calendars and made some tabletops, did that give you an edge in the entertainment industry, like the acting industry? Did it help you, or you still had to go through the normal struggle of waiting in lines? Or since a lot of people maybe already knew you, you could just walk into an audition room, or you still had to wait in lines?
I still had to wait in line. Now, you see that the process of being on those, what you call the little calendars, they're not little. What we call the small tabletop directories and the fashion, little fashion magazines, they're not little, because those are the things that now form you, form your confidence when you now get on the longer queues, inform how you decide to dress to that audition. So many factors that now gives you that edge starts from those little things you're calling little. They're the most important things. So yes, I still had to wait in line. The only difference was that I was now a confident girl waiting in line.
Mm.
I was now an experienced girl waiting in line. I was now a social girl waiting in line. I was now, you know, those things add so much that even on the line, you will stand out. Like, even if they come out and say, oh, next, they spot you, like, you just look familiar when you're prepared.
Mm.
Oh God, I can't explain. You just look familiar to people when you know what you're looking for. Don't know you. Actually, they don't know you, but just cause, like, everything just feels like you're ready for this. So eventually, even if you walk in and you don't get it, they remember you. Like, I mean, if you were what we're looking for, we would have actually gone for you. So you stick. Your pictures or something sticks. So it does that for you.
Wow. So what you're trying to say right now is that everything we do, we should, because from what I'm hearing is what you're doing is what doing well, because those little tabletops, not little anyways, but calendars and all those things still had an edge in your, in how you delivered in your auditions and had an edge in how you, you know, presented yourself. It really helped your courage and your confidence. And wow, that's really nice to know. True. So what film or what show did you first feature on?
Okay, so the very first was TV series for Wally Adenuga Productions. It was This Life first before Superstory. They had a series called the This Life. They still have it. I mean, Wally Adenuga Productions is a household name. Everybody knows the Superstory series. I started with This Life, and shortly after This Life, right after the first project, we were like, okay, we want her back for Superstory. And Superstory was like the biggest thing that could ever happen to TV.
You know, at that time.
Yes. Then there were not so many distractions, like, oh, we have the online channels, we have the, you know, I won't name all these platforms, you know, but as of then, we didn't really have too many of that. You know, it was just maybe you're playing a video game or you're watching that. Even the video games were very little. So that's how I got that. And that was the first major.
You know, growing up, I really, really did love Superstory. So I remember it was on, I think, every Thursdays or
every Thursday, 8 o'clock.
Yes. So I remember the day I saw you on the TV for the first, and I was amazed. I remember screaming, "Oh my God, that's Auntie Kenny, that's Auntie Kenny!" I was really impressed, and I was truly happy. And I'm once again flabbergasted by how you've turned out.
Thank you. This
is really inspiring.
Thank you.
At what point did you realize that you were famous?
So after Superstory, so I was in the market. Or I was going somewhere, and someone just came and slapped me behind. I think it was the market. They were like, "Ah, Caro, you're so wicked." So it took a while for it to click, like, and she was serious about it. So I was like, "Oh my God." So maybe back then they really believed most of the things you did on TV reflects who you are. They probably thought most of those things I did on TV reflected who I was. So I was like, you know, and then while she was at that, a lot of other people say, "Ah, she thinks we don't recognize them, Caro. Make things go cost for you for this market, too, because you wicked." So I was like, "Oh, you know." And then if I go into the bank, they say, "Ah, Caro, what do you want? Ah, you want to register with our bank? Ah, you know." And then so they would always connect where, they would always let me know
where
the popularity was coming from. It was Superstory.
Wow.
It was one bad apple, Superstory.
Wow. So. How do you really feel? Do people make you pay more knowing that you're famous? Like they said,
yeah, they
so
do.
So they charge you more than they would charge a regular person
they
because they feel, okay, she's making the million.
It's a difficult thing. This topic you just mentioned now, I think it goes way deeper than just because you're popular. It's an entitlement mentality that Africans have. It's bad.
Oh, wow.
I was just telling my brother yesterday, you know, you tell an African person or a Nigerian, for a fact, that one I know, that, "I just bought a car." And then instead of them saying, "Congratulations, let me send you a token for you to get your license done. Or let me send you a token for you to have your paper sorted." They say, wow. You're still looking for money to, you just made a major spending.
Okay.
Nigerians will tell you, "Come and wash it for us." It's a mentality they feel, "Oh, for you to have been able to afford that, there's more where that came from. Let's take it. You know, so yeah, they do that. It's a difficult thing, and it's not nice. You know, it's not nice.
So Auntie Kenny doesn't buy Rodo 50 naira anymore. She probably buys you like 1,000 naira now.
No, I would just make sure I don't go. I don't go to. And when I do go to the market, I'm like, some of them are nice actually. When they see you, rather than even try to charge you, they try to say, "Take it." I'm like, "No, this is your daily bread. This is your livelihood. Now, I won't take it." Then for such a person, I will now even give money. When I'm going, I'm done buying them, I can just give you a lot. But rather than doing that, a lot more people are selfish. They just want to take and take and take.
God bless our hustle. We've seen a famous person. Now let's bill her. That's what they call it. Let's bill her. Show us where the money is.
You know?
So as an actor, I'm very sure, because you're so talented, directors call you, send you emails, they want you on this project, they want you on this project, they want you on this, they want you on that. So how are you able to choose and decline? How are you able to know what you want and what not to accept? How do you do that?
It's still an ongoing practice. I'm still trying to learn how to do that. There's no Yeah, it happens a lot. I'm even still in the middle of making a decision, a couple of decisions now. Your management will tell you, well, this are the options, and this are the sort of like advantages, and of course, maybe one or two disadvantages. So it's up to you to look and make your decision. Now, what are the factors I look at? How much is being paid?
Definitely.
I want the money. Sure, I need the money. But sometimes it goes beyond money. Everything is not about money. Sometimes you want to know, how will it advance me? Is it going to add to my skill? Because we don't know it all. No matter how much experience I have, will I be a better actor on this? Will it help me to start acting differently? Because for me as an actor, once you have one style of crying, it's a problem. One style of shouting. People know how you cry. She'll still cry. No, it's a problem. So will this make me dig deeper, find a new dimension to what I do? Will I connect to it? Will I have a personal experience that will make me better as a person? Not even as an actor. Those are the factors. If the story is going to be, will it also make me meet people? What's it going to do? Will it make me travel more? Will it expose me more? Will it connect me to people more? What's, you know, is the other benefit apart from money? I look at that. If there's nothing, I don't take it. But if there's either one of those two, then I take it. So that's it.
All right. I have more questions to ask you, but we'll be back right after this break. Welcome back, guys. It's your boy Victor here again, and once again we are with the one and only Kehinde Bankole. So we left off where she was telling us that ego is important. So to all the directors out there and scriptwriters, she was telling us that your script has to be something that would challenge her, and directors, your money has to be there. So at times, because you know, in secondary school I was like the head of the drama team, and at times people come to me and they're like, oh, because we want to be like you, this and that, and it gets into my head, and at times, you know, we start to flop and mess up at times. So how are you able to balance all that praises and accolades and not let it affect your performance and who you are?
You look at the cloud, the stars, and when the stars come out, it's not just one. There's so many different sizes also. Some stars are like this tiny and huge, some are like this big. So that's to keep us to not get intimidated if there are stars who you feel are bigger than you.
Mm-hmm.
Also to keep you to be humble if there are stars you feel are smaller than you. Because all of you beautify the stars. All of you, in your own different shape or form or whatnot. So it doesn't get into my head because I'm like, if you don't do it, somebody else is going to be that talented. So God is amazing and he's gifted a lot of people. So it's got to be you in a group or you're out. So yeah, that's how I do it.
Yeah, sorry. So that's a lesson to me that I'm not the only one. So maybe I should calm down on my praises and all. You know, and there was a time I went for an audition because I want to be an actor too. Just saying. So there was a time I went
for it out there.
I'm just putting it out there, exactly, to all the directors and everyone listening.
Yeah, yeah. You know.
So there was a time I went for an audition and a lady stopped me and told me that, oh, I shouldn't bother because they only pick these like faces that they're used to. They only go for people that they are used to, that the entertainment industry isn't really searching for real people. What do you feel about that?
The entertainment industry is searching for new people. I can tell you that categorically. The only thing is that they're searching for new, talented people.
Mm-hmm. So you do not agree with the fact that they mostly go for music faces? Because I was listening to something on Instagram, someone's live on Instagram, and this lady, she surprised me. She's even someone I look up to. She's quite it in the industry. She's quite a bit. And she said she went for an audition one time, and then the only question the director asked her was, how many followers do you have on Instagram? And that was an eliminating factor for her, because she said that the director went for someone with higher followers than her. So what do you have to say about it?
To that, I'll say that there are many criteria to when film producers are searching, not directors.
Okay,
film, yeah, the idea is the producer of the film or the casting director for the executive review side. Of course, including the director. So it's not, the director is not the only person, but we have the key people, the, you know, casting director, when it comes to casting. So what I would say is, there are different elements people look out for when they're trying to make their film. Now, they are looking for new talented people. That's a fact that we've repeated several times. They are looking for new talented people.
So to those of you out there who are ready to go into the entertainment industry, you heard it from someone who is already there and she's big in it. They are looking for people like you. So stay tuned, don't give up, keep pushing.
Yeah. Except now, there's some films where they feel they need a selling factor. So maybe the selling factor will be a popular actor. Maybe the selling factor will be all the regions within the country kind of selection, where they want Igbo, Hausa, and Yoruba to be present. Each film will have what they think will make it pick, and they will look out for that. So if anybody gets eliminated because he or she is not popular, you're not eliminated for lack of talent. The criteria, the selection process then needed somebody that had attained a certain level of, you know, maybe following or popularity or salesmanship. Some people even get cast in films just because they can sell. So what they do is they use you that they feel you can sell, you that they feel you're talented. Talent is not enough for business. Remember, it is not just a show, it is show business.
Oh.
So sometimes the talent is there, but maybe you're so talented, but you're so quiet on social media, you can't pull people. So they would need not just you, they are in it for the business, they want to make money. So they'll need you, they'll need the people who have the crowd. And fortunately or luckily, there are some actors who don't have both the crowd and the talent. So those are the criteria. So if they didn't pick you, it's not because you're not talented. It's because that's not what they need at that time. You may be who they need, or you may not be what they need at that time. So subsequently, you keep trying. They may now have what they are looking for, their set factor, and then they add you onto the ensemble. So don't let that discourage you in any way, but it's an important tool in business anyway, that people look for popular faces or people who follow me.
So now I think I see this industry in a different light from what I see. Now I see that the directors and the executive producers are like businessmen that are actually selling.
Yes, they're in for business.
So they're in for the money. So, okay, so I understand it from a different light. So I think I perfectly understood what you just said.
Yeah, so you keep trying. Yeah. And while you're trying, also work on your social media. People are on social media and they don't know the reason they're there, or they don't use it efficiently enough. So start to use your social media platform efficiently enough to also.
I don't think people are listening. No, she said start to use your social media. Don't just be there watching other people live their lives.
Because you need to attract crowd as well. Sometimes when they cast you, they're casting you and your followers. They're casting you and the crowd you bring along. So you can't just be an observer all the time. You have to have your own stuff.
So to everyone out there, my Instagram handle is official_LaffyHallVictor. Please be sure to follow me so
sell it.
The directors could, you know, could tag me along in their next project. So, so how do you feel about your career right now? Do you feel you hit jackpot?
No, I won't even let you land. No, I haven't hit jackpot. Not out of humility, not out of like I'm teaching you to be hungry. No, there's more. Always more to reach out for. I want more international projects. Africa is so beautiful, we're so talented, our stories are so rich, are so deep. We've sat down in cinemas and watched the Western world tell our stories. They're telling it well. We should also attempt to tell it even better. So I want exposure, I want to make films that would be international. Be international. I also want to be on international projects. So I want to do more, both home and especially abroad. So yeah, a lot more.
So as you are right now, you still have aspiration, you still have aspiration. So to me right now, what you're saying is you're not there yet.
No, I'm not there. You know, that place for me, that day.
Crazy things are happening, crazy things are happening. If you need somebody grace, you fit job somebody's grace. Crazy things are happening, crazy things are happening. If you need somebody grace, you fit job somebody's grace.